This is the Eric John Phelps Show on 24/7 World Radio. And now, Eric John Phelps.
And again, I say welcome to the broadcast on this beautiful morning of Monday, November 23rd, 2015. This broadcast is the ministry of Reformation Bible Puritan Baptist Church, in which I am the elder bishop by office and pastor teacher by gift. This broadcast for the spiritual and temporal benefit of my people, the minority Caucasian races of the world, including the Angles, Saxons, Celts, Slavs, Teutons, Franks, Normans, Scotch-Irish, and every other branch of the white Caucasian race. Concerning spiritual matters, this broadcast of the edification of white men and preaching the gospel to unsaved white men, that they too may obtain salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Son of God, God manifest in the flesh, King of the Hebrew Jewish Israelites, and the great God and the Savior of the Church, that is the body of Christ, to the exclusion of Satan's Jesuit-ruled religio-political papal Roman Catholic institution, seated in Rome, that great city and great whore which rules over the kings of the earth, including Islam. Spiritually, this broadcast is also for the growth and maturity of white men in Christ, that we may continue to work out our salvation in fear and trembling, knowing that it is our holy God, the Father of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, with whom we have to do. Concerning temporal, political, cultural matters, this broadcast is also for the preservation of the racially white, Anglo-Saxon, Celtic, Slavic, Protestant, and Baptist peoples, historically used by God to break the power of the Pope's murderous and warring Dark Ages, that bloody disgrace to the history of man having spanned 1,000 years, from AD 606 to 1648. We shall be reminded that Caucasian, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, and Baptist Calvinists began the Protestant Reformation, which birthed the modern era in 1648, with the Peace Treaty of Westphalia ending the Black Pope's 30 Years' War, waged from 1618 to 1648. Therefore, a defense will be made for the preservation of the minority, white Caucasian Orthodox Christian, Protestant Christian, and Baptist Christian peoples, against our plotted racial, linguistic, cultural, historical, and national destruction by Rome, implemented by her Anglo-American international white power structure, using the mass murdering, anti-Christ, anti-Reformation Bible religions of Sunni Islam, Shia Islam, even though they're enemies, socialist communism and socialist fascism, its leaders, all of these leaders, secretly working together as directed by high-level Freemasons loyal to the Pope of Rome, as well as the Papal Caesar's international white power structure, imposing anti-Christ, unbiblical, socialist communist policies, resulting in forced amalgamation, that's forced race mixing, subsequent racial miscegenation, like the Muslims telling all the white women in Europe, we will give you babies. Who do you think those Muslims are being brought in by? The white power structure of the Pope, resulting in irreversible hybridization. Pro-black, that's right, miscegenate and race mix Europe so that there will never be a white nation in Europe ever again that will rise to resist the Pope's temporal power. You see why they're doing that? Resulting in irreversible hybridization, pro-black, anti-white government discrimination. All the whites in Europe are discriminated against by their own government. The Dutch, the Germans, the Swedes, they're all taxed to death. They can hardly afford to have children. Because it's about the destruction of the white Protestant Reformation nations of Europe. Continuing. Pro-black, anti-white government discrimination. That's the way it is here in America, same way it is in Europe. It's pro-black, pro-Muslim, anti-white, anti-Protestant discrimination all throughout Europe, all throughout here in America and Canada. all throughout Sweden, North America, and Scandinavian nations? Are we going to come to the conclusion that this is a design of the Pope, or this just happens? Or the Jews did it. How about that one? Massive black-on-white crime. An international genocide by a cleverly incited and orchestrated world wars. What do you think this black-on-white, Muslim-on-white crime is all about in England, in France, in Germany, in Sweden? What do you think is that? What do you think is the purpose of that? It's to miscegenate those countries, destroy the Reformation heritage of those nations and all the high civilizations they created. And then meanwhile, to drive the disarmed white people, because they're all disarmed. They can't fight back with guns, as we still can do here. To drive them all to desperation and beg the very governments that have discriminated against them and brought all these Muslims in and all these blacks in to beg them to help them and hence drive them into right-wing fascism and blame the Jews. That's the game. Massive black-on-white crime and international genocide via cleverly incited and orchestrated world wars. Further, a defense will be made for the preservation of the high and lofty yet simple white language of English, used by God to evangelize all the nations of the earth with English-speaking peoples, especially the British, Canadian, and American Caucasian peoples, slated for destruction. Even John Coleman talks about that in his book, Committee 300, the calculated design of the white race among white, historic white race nations. Eve T. too writes of it, and he's a Jesuit coadjutor in my book. Further, this broadcast calls for the voluntary separation of white, Reformation, Bible-believing, and anti-Roman papacy, that is pro-Julian calendar, anti-Jesuit Gregorian calendar, anti-World Council of Churches, Orthodox Christians, Protestants, and Baptists, to the establishment of a new white nation within Pennsylvania, having declared its independence from FDR's Jesuitical, de facto military government of quote-unquote the United States, our new nation to be called Pro-Baptical, to the exclusion of all other races except the racial Hebrew Jewish Israelites. I intend to found a new Geneva somewhere here in Pennsylvania. That's my intention. We'll call it Pro-Baptical. If it was done once in history, so it can be done again. Being AV-1611 Bible-believing, gun-owning, white Caucasian nationalists, we desire to enjoy God's blessing of Genesis 12, 1 through 3, as we bless Abraham's physical seed through Jacob, which racial descendants may voluntarily live among us while preserving their own Hebrew race, defined in the scripture of truth as quote-unquote the holy seed and quote-unquote the holy people. We then seek to rival the Pope's political control over blessed Jerusalem, quote-unquote the city of the great king, unquote, namely the risen Lord Jesus Christ, which includes the removal of the Pope's CFR-led, that's Council on Foreign Relations-led, Masonic, Sunni Islamic, pro-Nazi Arab leaders, as well as his CFR-led pro-Nazi Socialist Communist Masonic Jewish Labor Zionists, both sides covertly working together in dividing the Lord's land given to Jacob and his physical racial descendants in Genesis 28, verses 12 through 15. For these modern-day Freemasonic, quote, Islamic assassins and Roman Catholic Templars, unquote, rule Rome's revived, quote, Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem, unquote, i.e. Israel, for the benefit of the Jesuit white pope, Antichrist Francis I, overseen by the Jesuit black pope, Adolfo Nicholas, advised by the former Jesuit Superior General Peter Hans Kolvenbach, and to the obvious detriment of the Hebrews living therein, in Israel. That's why they're never allowed to win a war. That's why they always have to give up land for peace. That's why they always have to facilitate Hamas and PLO and all those other wicked sinners, denying the right of the racial Hebrew Jewish Israelitish people, their right to live in their own land given to them to their forefather Abraham through Isaac and Jacob. And if the Jews in Israel would stop fighting, that would be the end of Israel. But if the Muslim Arabs stopped fighting, that would be peace. That's right, I'm completely against any Arab living in Israel. Those Arabs have the highest standard of living than any other Arab country around them. And they're such hypocrites as to state they have a right to that land, and where they live, they turn it into a dunghole, as they do every other Arab Muslim nation. Lastly, this broadcast will seek to expose the universal power of Satan's anti-Reformation Bible, counter-Reformation, pro-cartel capitalist, pro-socialist communist, pro-socialist fascist, military company of Jesus, being in fact the revived Knights Templars, those devils, truly the devil's military and commercial company of the slain Osiris, risen to be the invincible Horus of Egyptian Freemasonic mystery religion, the actual destiny of the final Pope of Rome, he to be slain and rise from the dead, then to be the invincible Antichrist, the man-beast, to rule all nations for 42 months as quote-unquote the king of Babylon. Wonder why they're building Abu Dhabi and Dubai and Baghdad and all those cities. Why do you think the Western white power structure is building those cities for the Muslims? The Muslims using their money that they managed to get through the high technology of historic white Protestant nations to get oil out of the ground for them. Why did the white power structure make Saudi Arabia rich? Why did it make Kuwait rich? All these Sunni nations cater. Why did this white power structure of Europe and America make these Muslim nations rich? They're Sunni Muslim Islam controlled by the Pope through the Wahhabis and high-level Freemasonry. And they're building a new caliphate there for them, ultimately for the benefit of the Antichrist, because his kingdom will extend all throughout what is being built today as the second Sunni caliphate. That will be the kingdom of the final Pope of Rome, including Europe and North Africa, to be slain and rise from the dead. And that's why his cartel capitalists in the West are building that whole area for him. And we Americans are coolies, are the suckers, are the slaves to build this empire for the Pope of Rome. While not a preacher in this country will tell you that, except me and maybe a few others. For the order is demon-possessed. Father General, quote-unquote, the god of his surname, quote, company of the perfect, unquote, now rules every government on earth via the white pope's, quote, sovereign state of Vatican City and its papal knighthoods. On the advice of his secret 10-man Jesuit council, representing Rome's 10 most powerful papal bloodline families, these are bloodlines, as well as being advised by his 10 Jesuit assistants, they controlling high-level, illuminized, Satan-worshipping Scottish Rite Freemasons ruling the craft worldwide. The Jesuits, in their control of the sovereign state of Vatican City, rule all nations of the world today. That's why all the leaders of the nations of the world today go and suck up to the Pope. Oh, Holy Father. Don't destroy my currency. I have a lady that just contacted me. She was raised a Presbyterian. She has a friend that goes to the Vatican. He's a banker in the Vatican. And she asked him, she said, when Russia did so-and-so, she said, did you short the Russian ruble? He said, of course we did. The Vatican controls the ruble. The Vatican controls the dollar. The Vatican controls the euro. It controls the dinar. It controls all currencies. Not the Jews and not the Muslims and not the Protestants. It's the papacy, and the Jesuits run the papacy. That's right. It's designs and plots involving the control of world finance, world press, and the world intelligence community. The Jesuits run world finance, the world press, and the world intelligence community. They all work together. And only in this country is our right secured to freedom of speech, where I can say, you know, these people work together. And that's my freedom of preach. Freedom of preach rights secured by white Anglo-Saxon Baptist Calvinists, particularly the Calvinist Baptists of Virginia, led by John Leland, as he advised Madison, you had better put an amendment in that Constitution securing religious liberty to us Baptists. They control all those things. Well, it'll be proved. It'll be elucidated with historic irrefutable citations spanning over 300 years. All peoples of whatever race or nation will benefit if the biblical principles espoused in this broadcast are applied to themselves in accordance with the Word of God, the AV 1611 Reformation English Bible for English-speaking peoples. And now to begin. Well, notice, no matter what country you're in, the Pope runs your government. No matter what bank you use, the Pope runs that bank. No matter what currency you use, the Pope controls that currency. And the papacy's made very sure that none of us slaves and animals and beasts will ever have access to gold and silver coin anymore, because that would give us real money with intrinsic value that they can't control its value. You see that? And they control the intelligence communities. They run the FSB and the SVR because the CIA and the FBI work together with them. And the Mossad and the Pakistani ISI and German intelligence, BND, and the British intelligence, MI5, MI6, SIS. They all work together, including Chinese Secret Intelligence Service, Canadian Secret Intelligence Service. They all work together at the top, led by certain knights, controlled by the Jesuits, and they will do what they're told or they'll be pushing up daisies. Be back in a moment to begin our topic.
This is 24/7 World Radio.
This is Brother Jack. I invite you to listen to my broadcast on 247worldradio.com. I preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the Polish-speaking people scattered around the whole world. Furthermore, I defend the Reformation in Poland, Polish Protestants and Baptists, and Polish Reformation Bible. I also expose the Counter-Reformation in my homeland, led by the Jesuits and by the Roman Catholic Institution. Join me every Thursday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on 247worldradio.com. Tu brat Jacek, zapraszam Was do wysłuchania mojej audycji na 247worldradio.com. Głoszę Ewangelię Pana Jezusa Chrystusa ludziom mówiącym po polsku rozproszonym po całym świecie. Ponadto bronię reformacji w Polsce, polskich protestantów i baptystów oraz polskiej Biblii reformacyjnej. Demaskuję również kontrreformację w mojej ojczyźnie kierowaną przez jezuitów i przez rzymskokatolicką instytucję. Dołącz do mnie w każdy czwartek o godzinie 17 czasu wschodnioamerykańskiego na 247worldradio.com.
This is Brother Nicholas. Join me every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the German Bible Truth Hour, and at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the Dutch Bible Truth Hour on 24/7 World Radio. This is Bruder Nicolas. Ich lade euch herzlich ein, mich anzuhören, jeder Dienstag um 2 Uhr nachmittags, amerikanische Zeit, für die deutsche Bibelwahrheitsstunde und 3 Uhr amerikanische Standardzeit für die niederländische Bibelwahrheitsstunde am World Radio 24/7. Dit is Bruder Nico. U bent hartelijk uitgenodigd om elke dinsdag om 2 uur Amerikaanse standaardtijd het Duitse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen en 3 uur Amerikaanse standaardtijd het Nederlandse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen op 24/7 World Radio.
You're listening to 24/7 World Radio.
This growing anti-Islamic fury. Now, the Bible is clear we are to hate every evil way. We are to love righteousness and hate iniquity. Well, the Muslim religion of Islam is a wicked, satanic, ungodly, vicious, bloodletting, fanatical religion. And God hates it, beginning with the fact that it denies the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. And throughout the Muslim world, one of their sayings is, God has no son. That's what's written on the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. God has no son. Well, it's a blasphemous, ungodly, wicked religion. But how does it prosper? How does it prosper, you white men that are beating the drum against Islam all the time? How does it prosper? Or do you want to ask that question? I say you don't have the cojones to ask that question, because it's going to turn right to your masters, the Pope's white power structure. Who do you think created Al-Qaeda or Al-Qaeda? Do we forget the fact that the CIA created it? I have the picture of that dirty sinner, Zbigniew Brzezinski, with, I think, a 50 caliber machine gun, standing there with Osama bin Laden. What is the Roman Catholic Papal Knight Jesuit aid educated Zbigniew Brzezinski doing with Osama bin Laden, building up the Al-Qaeda and so on during the Afghan war with the Russian government? And remember, the Russian government's run by the Jesuits too. So what's the purpose of the Afghan war? To enable the U.S. military government to justify building up the Mujahideen and ultimately the Taliban and ultimately Al-Qaeda to be used, quote unquote, as terrorists against the West, against historic white Protestant Western civilization. But let's go back a little farther. And of course, we know, by the way, that the CIA created ISIS. That's right. The Central Intelligence Agency, the Catholics in Action, created the Pope's ISIS, led by Muslim Freemasons. And what is ISIS doing? Why, it's murdering, killing, quote-unquote, Christians, Coptic Christians and others, non-Roman Catholic Christians. Of course, they're all apostate. None of them believe the Bible, and none of them evangelize, and none of them will say what I say, and none of them seek to get the gospel out. It's just paganized non-Roman Catholic Christianity, which the Lord said he destroys. So what is happening? God's given these apostate Christians up to the Pope so the Pope can use his Islam to kill them. Exactly what's going to happen here, giving these apostate American Christians up so we can bring the Muslims over here to kill us for a while so we can be driven into right-wing fascism. And by the way, that's why they want to take our guns from us. That's why they want America to be a gun-free zone so we can all be victims of mass murder. Amen? Come on now. So ISIS is a creation of the CIA, and according to one particular gentleman that has done much on this, he says that there are 20,000 bank accounts of ISIS soldiers and leaders with UBS, the bank in Switzerland. My. But this military government wants to put all sorts of limitations and restrictions and more and more military limitations in this country in fighting ISIS, created by the CIA and financed by the bank, big bankers of the Pope in Switzerland. And my question is, are we going to fall for this? Are we going to be suckers to run off and fight and kill all the Muslims? Is that what we're going to do? And we Protestants and Baptists had better think about it, because we never, ever went to war with Islam. Islam went to war with the papacy. Let the Roman Catholics and the Muslims fight it out. It's not our war. Just stay out of our country. Catholics and Muslims alike, just get out. We don't want you here because you want to kill us. So kill each other. So let's go a little farther here. Let's go back a little farther. Let's go back at the establishment of Islam. Did you realize when Islam was established, Muhammad was tutored by Augustinian priests in North Africa? Did you know that? Why? Because the Vatican was building a military force to be driven by its religion to kill enemies of the papacy. Islam was created to be the hitman for the Pope. And you Muslims that are listening, prove me wrong. Show me any Muslim leader today that is against the Roman papacy. Show me one. Email me, eric@vaticanassassins.org. Name one that has any authority, any power, any backing that resists the Pope. There isn't one. And in the days of Muhammad, he didn't resist the Pope either. So Muhammad, the immoral, wicked man chosen by these Augustinian priests, Muhammad had a Roman Catholic wife. Did you know that? One of them. And as he was tutored by these Augustinian priests, the Quran was written in Rome. Muhammad didn't write the Quran. He was an illiterate. It was written by priests in Rome. Why do you think the Quran exalts Mary? I mean, why would Islam have any interest whatsoever in Mary? Why does Islam count beads just like the papists? Why does Islam have a center city, Mecca, just as Rome has, just as Roman Catholicism has a center city, Rome? Why does Islam have a specific language for its religion, Arabic, just as Rome has a specific religion for its religion, Latin? Why is it that Rome regards those who are not Roman Catholics heretics? We're not separated brethren pursuant to the Second Vatican Council. We're heretics pursuant to the doctrines of the wicked Thomas Aquinas in his Summa Theologica. Rome has its heretics and Islam has its infidels. What's the difference? Rome calls for the killing of heretics by any means necessary. Islam calls for the killing of infidels. What's the difference? Rome engages in what's called crusades. There were 13 crusades. 9 crusades, obviously led by the papists of Europe, backed by the Pope. The 10th crusade was the crusade of Napoleon Bonaparte. The 11th crusade was the crusade led by the British during World War I under King George V, that night of Malta. And the 12th crusade is being led right now by America. 12 crusades, all backed by the Pope of Rome, openly the first 9 and secretly the last 3. That's right. The Jesuits ran the British Empire. They run the American Empire. All for the benefit of the Pope of Rome. Inciting 2 separate peoples to hate and kill each other. Oh, Rome's a master at that. So what's the difference between Romanism and Islam? nothing. That's why I've always been preaching Islam is nothing more than Roman Catholicism for people of color. That's all it is. And the leaders at the top are just as much the lapdogs of the Pope as the leaders of Romanism. Now, I want to incite some of you Muslims to start thinking. Is that possible? Or is your fanaticism in Islam completely preempt you from doing any thinking on your own? Remember, I was giving out some tracts in Stuttgart, and this pretty little Muslim girl came up to me. She said, I wanted to give her a tract. She says, don't you know I'm a Muslim? Why do you do this? You know I'm a Muslim. I said, well, you're a very pretty Muslim, but don't you Muslims have the right to private judgment? Don't you have the right to think for yourself? Why don't you read it, and then if you reject it, give it to somebody else or throw it in the trash? Is your fanaticism so extreme that you can't read something and then decide for yourself whether or not you want to consider it? And that's correct, because you see, that's why there's no inventions in Islamic nations. They're not creators. They're not inventors of technology, because their religion prohibits them from thinking like that along religious lines. That's why Protestant nations are the greatest. We are the ones that are the greatest inventors. We are able to think. We have freedom of conscience and therefore freedom to invent. Do you see why destroying the Reformation destroys progress and advancements? And the advancements that are secretly made are going to be used just for the Jesuits and their white power structure, and all of us beasts can just live in a cave burning wood. Islam and Romanism are twin sisters. They work together at the top. But in the meantime, the government, the military government of the United States, is inciting all these men to unite against the destruction of Islam. I can tell you three or four white men that I know of, and they're older white men, that would love to see the total annihilation of all Islamic nations and people. And they're Protestants. And I ask them, what's wrong with you? I mean, I hate the religion of Islam just like you do, but to go and kill all those people? Who's inciting you to this? And then calling Roman Catholics Christians and trying to make us a part of the Roman Catholics? Protestants, Baptists, we're all Christians. We're not all Christians! They hate us. Roman Catholicism's killed millions of us, more than Islam could ever dream of killing. What's wrong with you Protestants and Baptists? Huh? How dare you side with Rome in anything? That old whore, that old harlot is the mother of harlots. She's the problem, not Islam. Islam is just her surrogate. It's her call boy. We deal with Rome, we deal with Islam. We expose the papacy, we stop the indignation of Islam against us. God will bless us for it. But if we side with Rome against Islam, the Lord will surely bring that sword here and include us in their death. Why, who, tell me, who do you think's... Who do you think's bringing all these Muslims into the country? You think the Baptists are doing it? You think the Protestants are doing it? Well, some of them, Bonesmen. Do you think the Jews are doing it? Well, some of their leaders, yeah, they're working with the white power structure. But who do you think's bringing in all these Muslims into America and Canada? Who do you think's doing it? I mean, I don't want them here. I do exactly what Trump said. You make me president, they're all going back. Absolutely, they don't belong here. To be a Muslim and to be a Republican is impossible. That's like being a he-she. That's like being a dog and a cat called a dat. It's impossible. They're going. But who brought them here? The people in control of immigration. Who runs the Department of Immigration? The military commander-in-chief, this military government. Who runs him? The Jesuits from Georgetown University. They run him. The Jesuits in control of this military government, manned by high-level Masons and Knights of Malta and Skull and Bones, are bringing in the Muslims into America. The Muslims are not running this government. Obama's a Roman Catholic. He was tutored by Jesuits, Greg Galuzzo and others. He may say that he's a Muslim, but the fact of the matter is he's just another Muslim pimp working for the Pope. Muslim pimps working for the Pope. It's like Osama bin Laden, just like Yasser Arafat, and the list goes on and on and on and on. Muslim pimps working for the Pope. And that's who's bringing these Muslims in here. The Pope. Bordello. House of Prostitution Bordello. Or pardon me, Bergoglio. Francis the First. That servant of Satan. The Jesuits are bringing in the Muslims in this country. And the question is, what for? To make America Muslim? Oh no, that'll never happen. To drive white men to the extreme, pardon me, of right-wing fascism, so the Jews can be blamed for it all. That's why. That's the real reason. There has to be a reason to round up the Jews of North America and send them all to their deaths at concentration camps. And one of the reasons will be, well, they caused the Great Depression, or they're in control of the treasury, or, in fact, these Jews, they run the country, and they brought all the Muslims in here. That's what David Duke says about Sweden. It's the Jews running Sweden, bringing all the Muslims and the black in there. That's what that Duke, David Dukey of the KKK says. They're going to do the same thing here. Will we stand against it? Back in a moment.
This is 24/7 World Radio.
This is Brother Jack. I invite you to listen to my broadcast on 247worldradio.com. I preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the Polish-speaking people scattered around the whole world. Furthermore, I defend the Reformation in Poland, Polish Protestants and Baptists, and Polish Reformation Bible. I also expose the Counter-Reformation in my homeland, led by the Jesuits and by the Roman Catholic Institution. Join me every Thursday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on 247worldradio.com. Tu brat Jacek, zapraszam Was do wysłuchania mojej audycji na 247worldradio.com. Głoszę Ewangelię Pana Jezusa Chrystusa ludziom mówiącym po polsku rozproszonym po całym świecie. Ponadto bronię reformacji w Polsce, polskich protestantów i baptystów oraz polskiej Biblii Reformacyjnej. Demaskuję również kontrreformację w mojej ojczyźnie kierowaną przez jezuitów i przez rzymskokatolicką instytucję. Dołącz do mnie w każdy czwartek o godzinie 17 czasu wschodnioamerykańskiego na 247worldradio.com.
You're listening to 24/7 World Radio.
The reason why they want us so busy we don't have time to think. So that's the purpose of the broadcaster, because he's supposed to have time to think. That's why he gets support from listeners. So he has time to do critical thinking so that he then can in turn to give his conclusion to the listeners. It's a win-win situation. So let's go back to our topic again. Muhammad is brought to power by Augustinian priests in North Africa. The Pope issued bulls for the support of Muhammad in Arabia. He financed it because, you see, the Pope was given spiritual power in 606. That's considered the beginning of the Roman Catholic papacy in 606. It actually begins before that. But when the Pope is given universal spiritual power by that wicked sinner Phocas out of Constantinople, this is the real beginning of the birth of the Roman papacy. But the papacy was not that strong. at the time. So it needed a surrogate. It needed an agent. It needed a hired assassin. So it wrote the Quran, made Muhammad its leader, gave him one of his wives, who was a Roman Catholic nun. And then Muhammad launched his jihads. And one of the things that he did is he took Arabia. He took Arabia. And his intent was to take all of the Middle East. Omar, he's the one who takes Jerusalem after Muhammad. And he takes it from the Eastern Empire, because the Eastern Empire, centered in Constantinople, is considered the enemy of Rome. And so remember, the Germans, the Ostrogoths and the Goths had come down and sacked Rome, ending really the Roman Empire 476. But by 606, the Pope's given universal spiritual power in Rome. And now he's going to create a surrogate. He's going to create an assassin. And that's called Muhammad with Islam. And the Pope will create a religion that will justify murder of what is essentially the enemies of the Pope. So they're going to kill the non-Roman Catholic Christians in Arabia. They're going to kill the Jews in Arabia. And when Muhammad dies, he will have taken all of Arabia and purged it of its Jews and non-Roman Catholic Christians. My question is, who benefits? Did not the Pope benefit with the sword of Islam? Of course he did. There were many Arab brethren that believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, sacrificed by the Muslims. Arab Muslims led by Muhammad. And then after Muhammad dies, Islam begins to spread because Rome can't let that die. So they're going to take Jerusalem with Omar. And Omar is going to build the Dome of the Rock on the Temple Mount and inscribe those blasphemous words on it, which says, God has no son, in Arabic. That's why when that Dome of the Rock finally comes down, I'm going to have a party. Praise God. And you know who's going to bring down the Dome of the Rock? Certain Muslim leaders working for the Pope of Rome, because the Pope wants to build a third Hebrew temple there. That's why Jerusalem and Babylon are the two most important cities to the Pope of Rome. The Jesuits, with their spiritual exercises, deal with the cities of Babylon and Jerusalem. You can read it in Wiley's History of Protestantism under the Jesuits, Volume 2, Chapter 15. So now, the papacy is going to further finance the Crusades, the jihads of the Muslims, as they storm across North Africa and reduce everybody to the sword or submission to Islam. They will cross over through North Africa, through Gibraltar, into Spain. And they will conquer Spain. You know why? Because there are a whole bunch of non-Roman Catholic Christians living in Spain called the Visigoths. And there are certain non-Roman Catholic Frenchmen living in the southern part of France. And so Islam will be permitted by the Pope to take Spain and to take a little part of southern France, and won't go far beyond the Pyrenees, separating France from Spain. But the Pope's using Islam as his sword against his enemies. And when all the enemies of the Pope are finally destroyed by the Muslims in Spain. Then Ferdinand and Isabella come along after 700 years of the Muslim occupation in Spain. And Ferdinand and Isabella come along, kick out all the Muslims in what, in 1492 or so? Remember, many a Muslim perished in the Inquisition. Not only Jews and Bible-believing people, but Muslims too. So now that the Pope had finished using Islam to eliminate his enemies in Spain and certain of them in southern France, because the Battle of Tours was the stopping of Islam coming all into France, and I'm convinced that battle was arranged so that the Muslim leaders would not continue to come into France. And so then Islam will ultimately be completely driven out of Spain by 1609. And there's still a tremendous remembrance of the Moors, of the Muslims in Spain. They left lots of their architecture, and many, many Spanish people are olive-skinned because of the interbreeding, intermarriage, intermixing of the darkened Muslims out of North Africa with the white Spanish people. Okay. Spanish Roman Catholics. You see, the Pope will miscegenate his own white Roman Catholics just to get to the Protestants and the Baptists so that there will never be real resistance to the Pope's temporal power anymore. That's why he's miscegenating his white Roman Catholics here in North America. He doesn't care about them. He just wants to stop any possibility of a white race people ever arising to read the Bible that would then turn and resist the Pope of Rome, as did the white Dutch, as did the white Germans, as did the white Swedes, as did the white English, as did the white Scots, as did the white certain Irish in Northern Ireland, as did the white South Africans, as did the white Rhodesians. We cannot, as did the white Australians, as did the white British, as did the white Canadians, as did the white Americans. We cannot have white Reformation Bible-based nations anymore. They have to be totally miscegenated by race and by religion. So bring in the darkened peoples of Islam. That'll do it. And this is only made possible by the leaders of these nations facilitating this invasion, because these leaders are high-level Masons or Papal Knights working for the Jesuits in their counter-Reformation design to destroy the Protestant Western civilization and the Reformation. This is how we understand this whole Islamic invasion. But let's go back some. Let's go back farther. In 1054, Michael Cerularius, who was the leader of the East, refused to accept the supremacy of the Pope of Rome, that he was the Bishop of Bishops. And the legate from the Pope on the spot excommunicated Michael Cerularius, who is considered to be the founder of the Orthodox Christian religion. And the Orthodox, they had the Byzantine text. They had the Greek text that we use for the Reformation to get the King James Bible to everybody. The Orthodox, I maintain, is the Church of Thyatira in the book of Revelation. Centered out of Constantinople. Constantinople became the richest city in the East. And for 400 years specifically, I mean, there was a crusade that went through Constantinople, and the Roman Catholic Crusaders sacked it. I think it was the Third Crusade. But for the most part, there was peace in Constantinople for 400 years, to the chagrin of the Pope. And so what they had to do is they had to Catholicize the religion of Islam. So they're busy worshiping Mary and the Virgin Mary, and it ultimately becomes identical to the Pope's Romanism. So God says, I've had enough. I will give Constantinople over to the Muslims and use the Pope of Rome to do it, my bulldog on a leash. Just like the devil's my bulldog on a leash. So the Pope of Rome used Islam to cause the fall of Constantinople in 1453, ending one of the major cities of Orthodoxy. And you Orthodox people that don't get the fact that Islam is a tool of the Pope, you're not seeing the big picture. And so now Constantinople is Istanbul. And the great big Orthodox church was changed into St. Sophia's Mosque. Do you see how the Pope benefited from the fall of Constantinople at the hand of the Muslims? That's why the Pope used the Muslims to fight with the Orthodox Serbs. The Serbs were considered the guardians of the gate into Eastern Europe. That's why the Serbian fighters are probably some of the greatest fighters in all of Europe. It's just generational. They were called the guardians of the gate because through Serbia was the gate into Europe, to Austria and so on. And the Serbs fought hard in fighting the Muslims when they came to the gates of Vienna. In the 1500s. Do you see how Islam benefits the Pope? And Europe has never been in danger of being overrun by Muslims, and it's not in danger today. Believe me, the Pope has a solution to this Muslim invasion he has caused. Now France is getting in on the action of bombing Syria. They're going to get rid of Assad, President Assad, because he's not playing games with the Pope. Assad refused to attack Israel for 40 years. The Pope must always have Muslim leaders that are going to wage war against Israel to kill the Jews but not destroy the country. Because it's his, it's the Pope's revived Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem. So Assad wasn't playing the game. They're going to remove him. That's why that papal mulatto slave of the Pope, Barry Davis Obama, is all about removing Assad. I thank God for Assad. I hope he stays in office. Assad protected the Christians in Syria. And it's ISIS that are the ones that are killing them and driving them out of the country. So now France, controlled by the Jesuits, is going to bomb Syria and destroy ISIS that's created by the CIA. You see, the Jesuits use one arm to build ISIS and their other arm to destroy the leaders, to destroy the manhood of ISIS. You see that? They do the same thing with Hamas. Build Hamas, then to turn around and destroy the leadership. Ultimately, securing the borders of the Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem. That's what's happening. The Pope's going to have his third temple, and he can't have a bunch of suicide bombers there wanting to destroy it. So he's just going to kill several hundred million of them in the 21st century. And the high Muslim leaders have agreed to this. Let's go back a little bit farther. In the 1700s, the papacy, using British Freemasonry, raised up what was called the Wahhabis. The Wahhabis started to become very powerful, and the first white man to go to Mecca, his name was Sir Richard Burton. He wrote the classic work, Arabian Nights. He was a pervert. Of course, as all the high Masons are, but nonetheless, he was the one that British intelligence was using to ultimately set the stage for the taking of Arabia by using the Wahhabis, who were Masons, subordinate to the Jesuits in London, running London. And so what happens? The Jesuits have their World War I. Pardon me. For the destruction of the Protestant Second Reich in Germany. Facilitated by their leader, Kaiser Wilhelm II, who betrayed the German people and did not evacuate 1 million German soldiers out of the USSR to bring them quickly across Germany to the Western Front to trounce the Americans, the French, and the British. That's why the Germans lost World War I through the treason of Wilhelm II, who relieved Bismarck of his command, opening up Germany for the assaults and destruction that would result as a result of World War I, orchestrated by the Jesuits. Well, during this World War I, or after World War I, during World War I, the Jesuits will use Turkey and the Young Turks to kill 1.5 million apostate Armenian Orthodox Christians. Mm-hmm. And Turkey to this day doesn't acknowledge it. But in 1932, after World War I, the Jesuits will use smoking Winston Churchill and Benito Mussolini to put the Saud family in power in Arabia, and hence we have the birth of Saudi Arabia in 1932. The Saudis are completely in the hands of the Pope. They always have been. Ibn Saud was nothing more than a pawn of the Black Pope, Vladimir Lerchowski, at the time. We'll continue on with this commentary. I trust you're enjoying it. Took a long time to find this out. I give it to you today. Be back in a moment after prayer, supplication, reflection, and seeking the Lord through His Son, Jesus Christ.
You're listening to 24/7 World Radio. From
white devil busy serving the Vatican, calling for a pan-European effort against Muslim terrorism. See what's happening here? I warned you. The intelligence communities controlled by the Pope have deliberately created this Muslim agitation throughout Europe to then use it as a justification for uniting Europe against a common enemy. Islam. See what's happening here? So now the French are stepping up their attacks against ISIS in Iraq, and the Russians are stepping up their attack against ISIS in Syria, and the Americans are stepping up their attack against ISIS that was created by the CIA. It's becoming what it appears to me to become a war of Europe, Russia, and America against Islam. Against all the Islamic peoples. And it's going to be a slaughter. Because there's a whole bunch of white men that are ready to kill as many Muslims as they can possibly kill and enjoy every minute of it. Thanks to the agitation brought about by the white power structure controlling the intelligence communities of all these nations, including France. So, it's coming. Third World War. Last one was against Germany. Particularly the white peoples of Prussia, the white Lutherans of Prussia, the white Orthodox of Russia, the white Reformed of the Netherlands, the white British Anglicans, I mean, the Jews of Europe. I mean, it was a tremendous harvest of heretics and liberals, the Jesuits controlling both sides of the wars, of the parties, Axis and the Allies. It's going to be the same thing in the 21st century, the Jesuit controlling France and Russia and America and any other nations that want a war against Islam, and on the other side, controlling the leaders of Islam. You mark my words, nobody's bombing Baghdad. Nobody's going to be bombing Baghdad because that's going to be the new capital, the caliphate. Nobody's going to be bombing Mecca, and nobody's going to be bombing Medina, well, unless, of course, they want to incite the Muslim world against the West. Yeah, I've said that they're going to blame America for blowing up Medina and Mecca. But all they need really is Baghdad for a second Sunni caliphate. And blowing up Mecca and Medina would then, and the Jerusalem mosque would then incite all of Islam to wage war against all the white Catholic nations, the white quote-unquote Christian nations. The white pagan infidel atheistic nations is what they really are. Is this making sense to you? And so it'll be the total war footing here, Canada, Europe, a total war footing against Islam for its decimation, so that the Pope's revived Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem will become more secure, while at the same time establishing a second Sunni caliphate to be run by Islamic Freemasons that have survived and the Wahhabis. Now let's go on a little bit farther. How did the Muslim nations get all their money? Were there Muslim scientists working in the back room, perfecting how to have oil drilling and oil refineries so that they, with their own technology, developed the huge oil fields of Arabia? Is that what happened? I don't think so. They were too busy killing each other. This is called the greatest commercial sale of the history of the world in 1934, when the Arabian deal was made with American Knights of Malta, like Felix Larkin and others, of Standard Oil of New York, whereby they agreed to develop the oil fields for Saudi Arabia, which would then make the Saudis and the Arabian nations and ultimately Kuwait and others the richest nations in the world. So that they would use the fortunes that they have been given by the white power structure for the purposes of the papacy. The Muslim leaders have to spend their money on what the Pope wants them to spend it on. And they can have all the whores and the white, blonde-haired, blue-eyed whores that they can bring into Arabia as much as they want, because that's what all these Muslims want, you know. Got to have me a white, a blonde-haired, blue-eyed woman. Whoa, yeah. As if the beautiful, darker-skinned, brown-eyed Muslim women are not pretty, you know. I had a pastor friend of mine, went to his church for many years, Nelson Turner. He used to work as a cook for one of the Saudi princes. And that Saudi prince was a whoremonger, a doper. Used to go out on his wife all the time, and Nelson told me he had a beautiful wife. Yeah. Got to have their white women, man. So Ibn Saud is put into power in 32. In 34, they have their huge commercial deal, the largest in world history. I document it in my book, Vatican Assassins. I got the picture in there. So that they can begin to flood tons of money and wealth into Arabia and the region occupied and controlled by the Muslims. So that Islam will begin to be financed. And it can be made into a sword for the Pope. And then they can begin to send their Muslim peoples out into Europe and in America and build mosques all around the country here. Where did they get their money to build the big mosques? From Saudi Arabia. Where did Saudi Arabia get their money to give it to them to build the mosques? From the Pope's white power structure that made them rich. Why do you think in the 70s they shut down the major oil wells in America? Why do you think we have been completely limited in our access to our own oil here in North America, in Canada, in Alaska? You realize the pipeline of Alaska, all that oil sent to Japan? We don't get that. I had a brother-in-law that worked on the pipeline up there. There was a bunch of tough white men building that, too. He saw a knife fight one day. Both guys got into a knife fight, and one of them cut the other's throat. A bunch of tough white men working on that pipeline. Well, they built that pipeline, and all the oil goes to the Far East. I guess they got to build China to prepare the China for our invasion here in North America. Got to give them plenty of oil. And we got to give plenty of steel to the Russians with cash for clunkers. We got to give plenty of those cars over to Russia so they can melt them down, make their war machine have more and more steel. Don't have to dig it out of the ground and process it and smelt it. They have it ready to go. And so the Muslim nations have become rich by the purposes of the white power structure, particularly the Sunni Muslim nations. The Shia Muslim nation like Iran, well, no, the British are going to steal their oil, and they're going to kill Mossadegh in the 1950s, and they're going to put that dictator in power. What was his name? The Shah of Iran. But ultimately now, it's still under the same papal dictatorship, but the phases change. And Iran's going to be humbled. There cannot be allowed to be Shia Islam as a rival to Sunni Islam. The Pope will not allow that. And so the Shia have got to go. That's why Iran will be invaded. That's why they told us that in their movie with their Hollywood whore, Angela, what's her name? In the movie Salt with Angelina Jolie. And one of the newer RoboCop movies where they're occupying Tehran. They're telling us what they're doing in the movies, man. So this is what they're doing. The Muslim nations were made rich at the expense of us Americans, us Canadians, because these traitors running the governments, these military governments, have sold us out and make war on us every day. Why do you think they flood the country with drugs so the Roman Catholic merchants of death and drugs can make trillions? The big banks serving as money laundering centers for all of it. And if you're not part of it, why then the DEA working for the Pope's going to bring you down. But he's not bringing down anybody involved with the Bush drug trade or any of the other big drug traders, King Juan Carlos and others. They've made us poverty-stricken, built up Islam to be our enemy, built up Russia, the Russian military government, to be our enemy. The Russian people are not our enemy. It's the Russian military government, the Chinese military government, to be our enemy, to drive the Chinese people to submission to then to be used to invade America. They just got to give them a reason to want to invade. That's what's happening. That's how Islam was built. And now they're infiltrating, they're coming over here to America, in addition to the Latin, Hispanic, Roman Catholics out of Mexico, Central America, South America. So that they can further destroy the white race peoples in North America and historic Protestantism. And include to destroy the white race Roman Catholics, because they don't care about the white Roman Catholics here in North America. They're liberals. Got to get rid of those people. That's right. And there's not a politician, not a statesman that will tell you all of this comes from the Roman papacy. And if we are ever to get back a civilian government with the repeal of the Emergency Banking Relief Act that imposed military government, if we are ever to get back civilian government that we've been deprived of for the last 82 years, the Roman papacy has to go. All the archbishops and bishops and cardinals, they all have got to be put on airplanes and flown to Rome with the sentence of death if you ever return. And all the Roman Catholics have to take an oath that they're going to uphold the Constitution of the United States of America, they're not going to uphold the temporal power, or they're leaving too. There will be a religious test, and the religious test is this. Does your religion call for an alliance, an allegiance to a foreign sovereign? Does your religion call for the persecution of someone other than you? And if that's the case, you're not allowed in the country. Out. And that ought to be the doctrine of every civilized nation that's historically white, Protestant, and Baptist. But we don't have anybody to advocate that today. Why, you're sexist, bigoted, and a racist if you say such things like that. That's how they want to shut you up from telling the truth. Just tag you with a term that no one wants to be tagged with. Hey, you tag me with anything, because it's either going to drop off or burn off. Everybody has a tag. It's going to drop off at the appearing of Christ at our gathering together unto him, or it's going to burn off in hell. Which leads me to our topic today. This is the white power structure, decimating the Reformation nations, decimating the Muslim nations, all for the benefit of the Pope of Rome, for his Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem, to create a new Sunni caliphate for the Pope of Rome to ultimately be his empire when he becomes Antichrist. I mean, all of it's benefiting the Pope. Because he's going to be the beast, the Antichrist, who is to come. We read here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the coming, not the second coming, but the appearing of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. The coming of the Lord, verse 15. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent or go before them which are asleep, those who have died in Christ. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. This is our gathering together unto him. This is the blessed hope of the Christian. It's momentary, it's imminent. Always has been. And it's being denied today left and right by so-called preachers. God help us. My hope is not the second coming. That's Israel's hope. My hope is the appearing of 1 Thessalonians 4, what the apostle refers to now in 2 Thessalonians 2. The coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 1, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us is the day of Christ, is at hand, namely the day of the Lord. Day of Christ and day of the Lord are synonymous terms. So there were some people spreading around, Christians there in the first century, that the day of the Lord was at hand. The judgment has come of the prophets. See, and many of them are saved Jews, so they know full well the prophets and the prophecy of the day of the Lord, book of Joel and so on. Zechariah. And they thought they were getting into the day of the Lord. So he says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first. What's the falling away? It's the word, it's a noun with a specific article, the definite article in front of it. So it's a specific falling away. And that word means departure. It's apostasia. So the noun is feminine, so it has hey apostasia. A specific departure is going to happen. And by means of that specific departure, then the man of sin can be revealed. Apart from that specific departure, he can't be. Except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. So it's a man that's going to be revealed, the son of perdition. And there are only two sons of perdition in the Bible. The first one is Judas, and the next one is the Antichrist. And hence, both of them are possessed by the devil. Judas was possessed of the devil to go out and betray Christ. This man of sin, the son of perdition, is going to be possessed of the devil too. Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worship, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Well, guess what? No more Roman Catholicism. It's gone. His 10 kings have destroyed Rome. Revelation 17. There's no more Islam. The Mahdi has arrived. The Antichrist is the Mahdi. No more Islam, no more Romanism, no more Buddhism, no more Hinduism. Krishna has arrived. It's worldwide worship, no more organized religion, and it's worldwide worship of this man who was the seventh Roman Caesar, a pope, slain with a sword, comes back to life to be the eighth Roman Caesar, yet he's one of the seven. He's in the same body, but he's completely different. He's going to have a new name, and he's going to be possessed of the devil. That's the purpose of the papacy. That's why the Jesuit Antichrist military order of the Sons of Loyola, that's their whole purpose, to facilitate the rise of the final Pope of Rome to be slain and rise from the dead to be the Antichrist, because those top Jesuits are busy worshiping Satan. And what does he do? He opposes and exalted himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God. What's this temple of God? It's not us. Apostle Paul talks about the church being the temple of God. The temple of God's not here when he comes to power. This temple of God, which is the Lord's body, has departed this world and is with Christ. We've been gathered together unto him. This temple of God is an earthly, physical temple. It is a rebuilt Hebrew temple in Jerusalem. It can be no other. He sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Nobody did that in the apostles' day. And what does he do? Verse 5, remember ye not that when I was with you, yet with you, I told you these things? He told them those things back in 1 Thessalonians about the departure to be with Christ. Now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. Well, what withholdeth is the restrainer, the Holy Spirit, residing in the church, the body of Christ. So therefore, there's no way Satan can manifest his Antichrist as long as the true body of Christ is in the earth today. Because greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. The Holy Spirit's greater than the devil. And the devil can't bring his Antichrist to power until the Holy Spirit is taken out of the way to not restrain the mystery of iniquity from coming to fruition in the manifestation of the Antichrist, the beast, the man beast. Because that's the end of the history of the Gentiles. Gentile world rule. He's the king of fierce countenance of Daniel chapter 8. And then shall that wicked be revealed, the wicked one will be revealed. That's the Antichrist, the beast, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy it with the brightness of his coming. That's Revelation 19. He takes the beast and he casts him in the lake of fire. Daniel 7 says the same thing. So the beast is confined to the burning flame. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. This final Pope of Rome, when he's slain and risen from the dead and takes on another name like Set or whatever, he's going to be the most powerful Gentile king who's ever lived. Satan will give to him all of his authority, all of his power that he has in this world system that's being designed so the risen Horus can finally sit atop the capstone on the pyramid and rule the world for 42 months, led and ruled by, guided by the devil. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. This Antichrist is a judgment of God on the nations who would have nothing to do with the Son of God. The more you reject the Lord Jesus Christ, the more you facilitate the judgment of God in the manifestation of the Antichrist, whose day, month, year, and time has already been determined, and we can't expedite it or slow it down. But notice, they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. Pardon me. You know what this means? This means that they can receive the love of the truth if they want to, but they won't. And because they won't, they can't. That's why no man can come unto me unless the Father draw him. Every man can come, but they won't. And so because they won't, they can't. And since they can't, the Father must draw them, namely the elect. God holds men accountable for not believing on the risen Lord Jesus Christ when they hear the gospel. They received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. Because you see, as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. But for those that will not receive him, judgment, horrors, the coming of the beast, the son of perdition, the man of sin. And for this cause, because they would not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved, this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. God would do that. Oh, God, how could you send anybody strong delusions? You love everybody and you're wringing your hands in heaven, hoping and praying that they'll really believe the gospel. That's an impotent, sick God. And it's not the God of the Bible. They would not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved, and I will send them strong delusion. The Lord sent the evil spirit against Saul for his sin. And so the Lord will do the same thing on a worldwide basis. Send a huge delusion that they should believe a lie. What's the lie? Oh, that the Pope's the savior of the world. How about that? The risen Pope, now he's risen from the dead. He's savior of the world. Let's all have a party. Let's celebrate Christmas, because Christmas is all about looking forward to the Antichrist. It's all about looking forward to the tree, the Pope, who's the final Pope, who's cut down in the field. He's died, and we're going to bring him back to life. We're going to bring it in the house and put it in some water so it can bloom. And we're going to put the star of Lucifer on the top of the tree. The feast of Christmas is looking forward to the coming of the Antichrist. That's why no Christian has a right to celebrate that damnable, ungodly thing. I make Christmas another work day. God deliver me. Someone says Merry Christmas to me. I say, oh, you too. Have a good day. Goodbye. But no Merry Christmas coming out of my mouth. What a wicked satanic feast. Has nothing to do with Bible-based Christianity. And the Puritans passed a law in Massachusetts that if you celebrated that wicked day, you were going to go to the stockade. Now that's godly. That's a good thing. That they all might be damned or judged who believe not the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. People today love sin, man. They just love it. They love fornication. I was just reading to Charlie Sheen. He has the one who all about Vatican assassin warlocks with Alex Jones wanted to, attack my stuff. See, God is righteous. God sent him HIV. After all, he had 5,000 women, supposedly. He did all these drugs. God is not mocked. Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Yep. People love pleasure. We'll be back in a moment. Continue.
This is 24/7 World Radio.
This is Brother Jack. I invite you to listen to my broadcast on 247worldradio.com. I preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the Polish-speaking people scattered around the whole world. Furthermore, I defend the Reformation in Poland, Polish Protestants and Baptists, and Polish Reformation Bible. I also expose the Counter-Reformation in my homeland, led by the Jesuits and by the Roman Catholic Institution. Join me every Thursday at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on 247worldradio.com. Tu brat Jacek, zapraszam Was do wysłuchania mojej audycji na 247worldradio.com. Głoszę Ewangelię Pana Jezusa Chrystusa ludziom mówiącym po polsku rozproszonym po całym świecie. Ponadto bronię reformacji w Polsce, polskich protestantów i baptystów oraz polskiej Biblii reformacyjnej. Demaskuję również kontrreformację w mojej ojczyźnie kierowaną przez jezuitów i przez rzymskokatolicką instytucję. Dołącz do mnie w każdy czwartek o godzinie 17 czasu wschodnioamerykańskiego na 247worldradio.com.
This is Brother Nicholas. Join me every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the German Bible Truth Hour and at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the Dutch Bible Truth Hour on 24/7 World Radio. This is Bruder Nicholas. Ich lade euch herzlich ein, mich anzuhören jeder Dienstag um 2 Uhr nachmittags, amerikanische Zeit, für die deutsche Bibelwahrheitsstunde und 3 Uhr amerikanische Standardzeit für die niederländische Bibelwahrheitsstunde am World Radio 24/7. Dit is Bruder Nico. U bent hartelijk uitgenodigd om elke dinsdag om 2 uur amerikaanse standaardtijd het Duitse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen en 3 uur amerikaanse standaardtijd het Nederlandse Bijbelwaarheidsuur te volgen op 24/7 World Radio.
You're listening to 24/7 World Radio.
And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned or judged who believe not the truth, but had pleasure, had delight in unrighteousness. They took pleasure and delight in unrighteousness. Well, that's about the American culture today. They go out to these discos and where the lights are going on. By the way, the Pope's mafia runs all these discos, you know that. Every time you go out discoing, you're feeding the papacy. Every time you go out to these bars, everybody's dancing and the lights and whatever. You're feeding the papacy. And the papacy runs all the big alcohol conglomerates. I mean, I drink wine and I drink some strong drink every now and then, but I'm not out boozing it up and getting drunk and getting high. It's a sin. And when I have a little glass of wine, whatever, I have it in my home. I'm definitely not out on the road where I might damage somebody. The disgrace of the gospel. But these people, they're out at the discos and we're going to drink and we're going to take another shot of whatever it is. We're going to get out and dance. We're going to lose all our restraint. And hey, why don't we go home to my place so we can fornicate or commit adultery? That's what people go to bars for. You want to drink, go out and commit adultery or fornicate. Do you realize how dangerous that is? I mean, it's tantamount to taking a .38 revolver, putting a slug in it, spinning the wheel and spinning the barrel and spinning the, what is it called? Spinning the wheel and putting it back in the gun. Then cocking the trigger and cocking it and pulling the trigger and put it against your head and see if it goes off or not. That's Russian roulette. That's what you're doing when you go out to these places and you're dancing it up and going home with some stranger and fornicating. That's how everybody gets HIV. That's how everybody gets all these venereal diseases. A sobering thing for you to do would be just to check out venereal disease on the web. Just check it out. And then ask yourself, do I want my penis to look like that? Do I want my fingers to look like that, or my lips with all these growths on it? Or do I want holes growing in the roof of my mouth, because that's what syphilis does? It starts to grow holes in you. That's right. You need to look at it. If you're old enough to have sex, you need to realize what a shotgun is waiting for you if you dare go out and start fornicating around and looking for some strange. Now, one friend told me in one of my last meetings how he got the crabs from some woman he was going to college with. And scabies or other things like that. Oh, but is it worth the pleasure? Is it worth the pleasure? Really? Well, I would say that a very large percentage of the American young population wants to take drugs, wants to go out and fornicate, wants to listen to this sick, savage, disco, whatever kind of music noise it is, then get all incited and their central nervous system's going wild to go out and then fornicate and commit adultery with somebody. It's sin, and God will recompense us according to our works if we do that. And one of the recompenses is a more tyrannical government, because an immoral people can never keep a government in its place, limiting its power. An immoral people can't do it. Why do you think the Pope put pornography up here all across the web? To drag us into sexual immorality that heightens demonic activity, further reduces us to poverty, and makes us subordinate to a tyrant controlled by the Pope. That's the purpose of all this sexual sin. Why do you think the devil has it in style today in America, and I imagine in Europe, for all these women to walk around in skin-tight leotards out in public? Why? Because it's an invitation to fornication, to adultery, to sexual impurity. Come on with me, honey. And sexual adultery, fornication, whatever you want to call it, lesbianism, sodomy, it's all a gateway to more demonic activity, poverty, shame, bad conscience, sickness, a host of things. Sigmund Freud said, this whole business about the sex thing and anal, oral, and genitalia, he says, we're going to release on the American people the plague. And it is a plague. There's more viruses, sexually transmitted diseases, which are really sexually transmitted devils, than ever. You realize these viruses are intimately connected to cancer? Do you realize cervical cancer is a result of a multitude of partners and sex for these women? That's what causes it. We're judged for what we do in this life and what's coming on the world because of their complete and total being given over to sports and football and basketball and baseball and whatever, and as well as sexual immorality and taking dope and drugs. This complete party that's going on in Western civilization is going to come to an end with economic breakdown, decimation in major cities, justifying war overseas against the Muslims, and then ultimately our military to be betrayed and then sacrificed, and then ultimately the final coup de grace is our invasion. That's what's going to come to an immoral, wicked, ungodly, Christ-rejecting, AV 1611 Reformation Bible-rejecting culture of white men and white women in this country. That's what's coming. So just picture your little dear children out there in slavery because of your sins and your rebellion against God. The children that you live for will be enslaved because of our sin of refusing to forsake it, to believe on Christ, and to start to live right before God. Because, you see, we've taken pleasure, delight in unrighteousness. We like it. We love it. We live for it. We don't live for principle anymore. We don't live for conviction anymore. We used to. 80 years ago we used to, but not now. Now it's one huge pig fest. Well, as a result, we have judicial tyranny in the courts. Or we have what's called a military jurisdiction in the courts. And this military jurisdiction is not the civilian due process of law secured by the Fifth Amendment on a federal level and secured by Section 1 of the 14th Amendment on a state level. Now, as you know, I teach my course, my private citizenship course, private American citizenship course. I recommend that all of you take it. It's only $1,850. It's a 3-day course. Worth tens of thousands in just material alone. It's things you don't have to dig out for yourself. They've already been dug out over the last 20, 25 years. And when you become the private citizen of the United States, once again, protected by the Constitution, you and you alone are the only one capable of stopping the military jurisdiction of the court. The military jurisdiction being utilized by the U.S. attorney or the district attorney if it's a county matter in a state. Nobody else has the ability to do it because nobody else has constitutional protection. You see, you can live under the protection of the Constitution or you can live under the oppression of Proclamation 2040, Trading with the Enemy Act as amended by the Emergency Banking Relief Act, that unholy trinity. You only have two choices where you want to live. The Christian man, the Bible-believing Christian man who honors the king, honors the sovereign people who spoke by way of the Constitution, and therefore the Christian man should live under the protection of the Constitution, that white Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, and Baptist document. Born out of the Reformation, born out of the Puritan Civil War, born out of the Dutch Republic. Because remember, our government was fashioned after the Dutch Republic, not after Great Britain. Britain has no constitution. The Dutch Republic did. Britain never had a Declaration of Independence. The Dutch Republic did have a Declaration of Independence. So therefore, you filed your declaration of status. It's now a public record that you're the private citizen of the United States. And now comes the arrest. When you're arrested for whatever. Here is what I teach when you are being threatened with arrest. Of course, of all, you're nice to the police officer because he has a terrible job. I was raised by a police officer, became a chief of police in Richmond, California, so I have a sympathy for the cops. So, when they want to see the driver's license, registration, proof of insurance, you hand them this card too. And here is what this card says. To all officers and agents of federal and state military governments. Number one, I am a private American national citizen of the United States. My citizenship status is protected by Section 1 of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution for the United States of America. I am not a quote-unquote sovereign citizen or a quote-unquote sovereign state citizen. You want to make very clear you say that. Because this sovereign citizen nonsense is absolute anarchy and unconstitutional and ungodly and wicked. Number two, therefore, I have the right to a civilian due process of law on both a federal and state level, secured by the 5th and 14th Amendments to the Constitution for the United States of America. So what you're saying there is I have a right to the civilian due process of law. The officer might say, well, what does that mean? Well, it means, officer, is what you're doing is you're enforcing a military due process of law. You see that flag on your shoulder there? You see how it's trimmed in gold fringe, officer? That's a military color. You're enforcing a military jurisdiction, officer, by merely questioning me. And so therefore, I just want to tell you, let you know that I have the right to a civilian, non-military due process of law on a state level here, secured by Section 1 of the 14th Amendment, or if it's a federal, if the FBI come and talk to you, hey, same deal. It's a military brotherhood. It's a military agency and acting on behalf of the military government. So are you questioning me pursuant to my civilian due process rights, Mr. FBI agent? You've taken an oath, haven't you, to uphold the Constitution of the United States, haven't you, Mr. FBI agent? Why, yeah. Well, then you've taken an oath to give me civilian due process of law. So that's my second point. My third point is, therefore, I release and discharge you from your obligation to impose upon me your military due process of law. We had a gentleman from the Treasury come and talk with these people that were on trial in St. Louis a couple of years ago, St. Louis, Missouri, and they used some of my paperwork. And the guy from the Department of the Treasury told them, you have to release the judge of his obligation to give you this due process he's given you. Now, that came from a Treasury agent. I kind of think he knows what he's talking about. And so what we say here is, therefore, I release and discharge you, you officer, from your obligation to impose upon me your military due process of law. Because you see, these police officers are bound to give you a military due process of law by virtue of the statute that's in place during this temporary emergency. The statute's the Trading with the Enemy Act. The section is Section 17. So because you're under a higher law, the Constitution, you then have to untie the hands of the police officer by releasing him and discharging him from his obligation to give you military due process. Now that you have untied his hands by discharging and releasing him, you then go to the next paragraph, paragraph 4. Further, I accept your public oath or affirmation to support and defend the Constitution for the United States of America, taken in accordance with Article 6, Section 3 of said Constitution. Now, what does that say? What does that Constitution say in Article 6? In Article 6, Section 3, it says here, the senators and representatives before mentioned, and the members of the several state legislatures, and all executive and judicial officers, both of the United States and of the several states, shall be bound by oath or affirmation to support this Constitution. That's the Constitution. That's Section 6. That's Article 6, Section 3. So every police officer has taken an oath to uphold the Constitution, to support the Constitution, which includes a civilian due process of law when dealing with the private citizen who's going to claim that right. Because he who claims no rights has no rights, even if they're there for you. So again, further, I accept your public oath or affirmation to support and defend the Constitution for the United States of America, taken in accordance with Article 6, Section 3 of said Constitution. So I'm accepting your oath, and now I'm binding you by your oath. I've released you from your statutory obligation to give me military due process, and I am binding you by your oath. I'm accepting your oath by which you are bound to support the Constitution, and therefore you're bound to give me some constitutional, lawful, civilian due process of law. Here, officer. Number 5. Therefore, I am not subject to, nor can you impose upon me, your military due process of law of your military government. Can't do it. If you're going to question me, arrest me, whatever, it has to be pursuant to a civilian due process of law that you've sworn to uphold in the Constitution. And if you're going to tell me that, that's great. But they're never going to say that. Because they cannot give you a civilian due process. All they can give you is a military due process. So now the entire questioning and arrest has been done contrary to your civilian due process right of the Fifth Amendment, if it's federal, a federal guy, or the 14th Amendment, if it's a state police officer. You like this so far? The next statement. Now that you got that all out of the way, they're going to want a contract with you. Well, just do what we tell you to do. Or whatever. They're going to try to initiate some contract with you, try to move you off your place, try to get you to abandon your position of constitutional protection. And so therefore you're going to say, I do not consent, one time. I do not consent, second time. I do not consent the third time. You're going to say it 3 times. I do not consent, I do not consent, I do not consent to be an implied trustee of your temporarily imposed military due process of law utilized by your temporarily imposed military jurisdiction of your temporarily imposed military government of the Commander-in-Chief ruling Washington, D.C. I'm not consenting to this military due process. I'm not consenting to be trustee of this military due process. Because that's how they treat you in court, as a trustee. You're setting the record for court. Okay? And lastly, finally, I have nothing more to say and stand mute. I'm not going to engage in the benefit of discussion. I've given you my card. I've read it off to you, officer. Or handed it to him. And the essence is, I'm the private citizen of the United States, protected by Section 1 of the 14th Amendment. I have my right to civilian due process of law that I'm claiming, protected by the 5th or 14th Amendment. I have released and discharged you from your obligation to give me statutory military due process out of Trading with the Enemy Act. And I'm accepting your oath of office to uphold and defend the Constitution that you took pursuant to Article 6 of the Constitution. So now that we have that all settled, officer, I just want to let you know that I'm not subject to your military due process or your military government here. And furthermore, I don't consent to it. Even though I'm not subject to it, I still could consent to it. I still could contract with you and consent to it. So I just want you to know I don't consent to being a trustee of your temporarily imposed military due process. I don't intend to consent. I'm not consenting to be subject to your military due process as a trustee. And now I don't have anything more to say. So that is how you should handle, I recommend how you should handle any meeting with the police officers. Okay? Because all their questioning is going to be a military due process. Their arrest is going to be military due process. And tomorrow I'll cover, or pardon me, Wednesday I'm going to cover how to handle yourself at arraignment. You've already set the stage with this card at the time of arrest. Now you want to end it at arraignment in a criminal matter. I will show you how I would do it. And a couple that has done it for 10 years in the state of New Mexico stopped 300 criminal and civil issues with their simple stand on the Constitution. They're American citizens. They're entitled to civilian due process of law. And when the court wouldn't give it, or the moving party, the district attorney or the U.S. attorney would not certify for the record, he's given military, given civilian due process, the court abated or dismissed. It's all about status, you being a private citizen, and it's about claiming your constitutional protected right of civilian due process. And when they don't agree to it, dismissal of the case or abatement of the process. 1, 2, 3. I'll be teaching this in Houston. So I suggest you come to my Houston course. I'll be getting into this in lots of detail. And any of you FBI agents that want to attend, I tell you what, you'd let me know you're an FBI agent outside of the class, and I'll let you in for free. But I'm only going to take one or two of you, because I think you guys need to know. You guys need to know what you're doing. You need to know how the Bureau functions. You need to know who you're working for. And you need to know such constitutionalists, Protestant freemen and Baptist freemen such as myself, who are not sovereigns, how we're going to handle matters. And how you should obey, because you've taken an oath to uphold the Constitution. So when someone puts the question to you, is this a civilian due process pursuant to the Fifth Amendment or a military due process pursuant to Training with the Enemy Act? And you answer them, well, it's military due process. Well, then I do not consent. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Don't consent to their military jurisdiction, because this military government is waging war on us. It hates us, and it wants to destroy us, as it is raising up Islam to be one of our killers. Brother Eric John Phelps, thank you for tuning in today. I trust you had an enjoyable listen today at the broadcast. Please send your donations to Reformation Bible Church, P.O. Box 306, Newmanstown, Pennsylvania, 17073. For those of you who wish to support on a monthly basis, you can go to the website and give a monthly donation. You can just program yourself with that. And if you want to give, checks, just again, send them to the address I gave you. And please pray for me that the Lord would bless, because I intend to spend all of it for this purpose of getting this message out, of preaching the true gospel, of exposing a Jesuit order, and setting back the military jurisdiction of this de facto government instituted by FDR on March 9th, 1933. Please go to my website, VaticanAssassins.org, 247worldradio.com/mobile, and you can listen to this broadcast without downloading an app. It's 247worldradio.com/mobile. Go to my website, purchase some things that I have there. And lastly, I need your prayers for 60 seconds a day. If you know the Lord, would you please pray for me 60 seconds a day? I need every second. So until Wednesday, the Lord bless you as you do His will according to His word. The Reformation English Bible. Maranatha, the Lord be with you.
This is 24/7 World Radio.